have questions, all the delegates of this session will answer those questions. Now we are going to welcome Dr. Shahid Jamil. He is serving as the Chief Executive Officer of Biotechnology India Alliance since 2013. He has served on review and advisory committee of Government of India and World Health Organization. And we especially like to thank him for sponsoring CIRI since 2016. And I request him to please go ahead. So he's going to show us a video for 8 minutes. So I think that is how our talk will start. So please welcome him. Thank you.
This one?
This one.
Okay. So I'm going to go over the next 15 minutes or so telling you about the Wellcome Trust DBT India Alliance, affectionately called India Alliance. This is a funding program between Government of India and DBT. We were established in 2008 as an equal partnership between Wellcome, which is a large British charity, and the Department of Biotechnology, Government of India. This is sort of our timeline. In 2009, we came up with a fellowship program that supports people at three different levels of fellowships, early career, intermediate, and senior. In 2011, we introduced another fellowship, which is called the Margdarshi Fellowship, which is a set of centers of excellence. 2013, we set up a separate committee to look at clinicians and public health researchers who do biomedical research, because it was important for everyone to understand the differences of the unique career trajectory that these people have. As any good program, we have also undergone reviews. So we went through a review in 2011 to see how things were going, and one in January 2017, which assessed how we did over the past 8 years or so. And based on that, a new 5-year funding program has been approved, which will kick in April next year. And that 5-year funding program, where DBT is doubling its share, so Wellcome will stay at whatever it's given, DBT is going to double its share, which effectively means that we get 50% more money to play with. And with that money, we're bringing in not just fellowships. Fellowships will continue, but what we are bringing in are team science grants. So these would be multidisciplinary, multi-institutional grants that help solve an important biomedical problem for India. So that's going to be more in a mission mode kind of program. And also there is a feeling that we must enhance clinical research in the country. So strengthening of clinical research would be another thing that could come up. And as always, these would be advertised as and when they are announced. Our mission really is to enable biomedical research in India through both funding as well as engagement with scientists, engagement with the public as well. We are really there to empower scientists, empower researchers, and create the next generation of science leaders for the country. That's really the overarching goal of the program. While doing that, we bridge gaps. We bridge gaps that facilitate engagement with science, between science and society, and design interventions to really meet system goals and challenges. So for example, a program that we've started this year, which is called the India Research Management Initiative, really looks at research development offices in institutions and the value of these offices to institutions, while also providing a career path to trained researchers who want to go into management of research. And as always, we strive for excellence, but we encourage diversity, we encourage inclusivity and transparency in the science. Our work so far between 2009 and 2018, we have given 320 fellowship awards. And as you will see in this graphic, 80% of the awards, 30% to early career fellows and 50% to intermediate fellows, 80% of the awards really cover people early in their careers. So typically an early career fellowship is given to somebody who's within 4 years of their PhD or MD. And an intermediate fellowship is the most popular of our fellowships because it enables people like you in the audience who go to India with their first faculty position. So that's really a very popular award. And as you will see, we like to fund people very early in their careers, engage with them early in their careers, and empower them. Our fellowship spread is across the country. So at latest count, we fund people at 93 different institutions in India in 34 different cities. So no matter what anybody tells you, we are not a Delhi, Bangalore, Pune program. Although yes, there are more fellows in those cities than anywhere else. Beyond science, we run training workshops, science communication workshops, getting physicians engaged into research. Very important is to build leadership in research, and we conduct workshops for that. And through various programs, by now we have trained about 3,000 PhD students, postdocs, junior scientists across the country. We do a lot of public engagement activities, mostly in the health sector. I'm not going to go through all of this, but our latest one is something called Superheroes Against Superbugs, which is a school program, a program in schools empowering school children to understand what antimicrobial resistance is and build them as ambassadors of society to address the antimicrobial challenge. Research ecosystem improvement, I already told you about AIDMI, the Research Management Initiative. We are very serious about this issue of women in science, and I will show you something a little later. And we take part in various international programs on ecosystem development, like Together Science Camp, the Welcome Open Research Model, and have recently started something called the Africa-India Mobility Fund, where we fund researchers from India to go to Africa for short periods of time. And similarly, Welcome Trust, through the African Academy of Sciences, funds African researchers to come to India for short periods of time to build some messages. This is how we manage the grants. So those of you who may be interested in applying, you will write a preliminary application, which will be a very simple application, 750 words, a two-page CV, which is assessed, and then people are invited to write a full application, which is then internationally peer-reviewed. And when I say internationally peer-reviewed, greater than 90% of our applications are reviewed outside India. This has nothing to do with quality of science in India. I think the quality of science in India is very good. It's just that the research ecosystem is small, and therefore every applicant is somebody's student or somebody's postdoc or somebody's colleague or the student of a colleague. Too many conflicts of interest, so we really like to get things reviewed internationally. Which means that you would be expected to write a grant similar to an NIH grant or a European Commission grant. And that immediately brings in a level of, brings in quality and a level of stringency to the system. After the reviews, the applications are also read by people on our committees. And again, our committees have very international character. Committee members score applications, and then a decision is taken who to invite for an interview, and the final level is the interview where the committees decide who to award the fellowship and who not the fellowship. So in the audience, I can see at least two people who have experience of this. Abhijit here has been one of our early career fellows, so he can tell you all the good, the bad, and the ugly about the fellowships. And Shinjini is a committee member in our clinical fellowships program, so she can perhaps tell you the same about the process. I think the process, what is important is that we have a fully integrated online system, which was the first in India to do everything online. There's no paper trail. Everything is done online, from submission to reviews to decisions. We provide both pre-award and post-award support. That's what the office is for. You can call, you can email, and get guidance. I've already talked about committees. The feedback provided by the committees is often very useful, even to people who don't get the fellowship, because the bulk of people who apply to us actually don't get the fellowship. Our funding rate is about 10% at this time. We also pride ourselves in good governance. 95% of the funds that we get go towards fellowships. Only 5% of funds go towards administrative costs. Our philosophy really is to find the best people, find them hard, drive them hard, but then fund them well and fund them flexibly. You can move money around once we give you the money. And importantly, fund them on time. For a researcher, getting money is important, but getting money on time is equally important. And we really like to nurture people for future leadership roles. This is a slide that Siddharth Jhunjhunwala, the young faculty member at IISc, sent me. And Siddharth did a comparison of starting a lab in India or starting a lab outside India. And what he shows here is the clear bar is for US, the blue bar is for India on the left. And you will see that in India it takes about 1 crore to start a lab, 100 lakhs, 1 crore to start a lab. In comparison, in US, it's about 5 times more. If you exclude salaries, which is about 50% of grants in this country, again, the differential is quite a bit, about 2.5 times. And if you go by